Bam!
Mr. Taru, in this video, we're going to take a look at a question inspired by the 2017 Calculus AB exam question number 6. In the description of the video, you'll find a link to the AP Central website. We can download a PDF of all of the 2017 actual questions and really many, many years of previous years' questions, PDFs of the solution or the marking schemes, and then PDFs of the master graders' commentary, so you can see where students commonly earned and lost their points on these questions. You'll also find timestamps to the four parts of this question, so you can jump ahead if you like. Part A is going to be a derivative at a point. Part B is going to be taking a derivative and making sure you understand the chain rule properly, given to you in a slightly weird format because we have tables and graphs. We're going to be talking about the product rule, and then finally, something that uses the fact that we have this information here that g is a differentiable function, which means it's going to be therefore continuous, a condition required for things like intermediate value theorem and the mean value theorem. So part A in the original problem, let f be the function defined by f of x is equal to the sine of 3x times e raised to the cosine of x. Let g be a differentiable function. The table to the right gives the values of g and g prime, voila, and selected values of x. So just the fact that we're given a table of values does not allow us to look at the function of g and determine whether it's going to be differentiable or continuous at certain values. But the fact that they're telling us that g is differentiable means that we know that g is also going to be continuous, like I previously said. Okay, so, and this graph of h is going to be used in a later part. Find the slope of the line tangent to the graph of f of x is equal to the sine of 3x times e to the cosine of x at the value of pi over 2. So let's just make sure that we're comfortable using the product rule and the chain rule at the same time and just knowing our unit circle with evaluating that derivative at pi over 2. So f prime of x is equal to the first times the derivative of the second. So we have the sine of 3x. The derivative of e to the cosine is e to the cosine times the derivative of cosine, which is times negative sine of x, plus the second times the derivative of the first. The derivative of sine is cosine. And then finish that chain rule, times e to the cosine of x. You can clean this up if you want, but we're being asked for the numerical value. We want f prime at pi over 2. I don't really necessarily care about a cleanup version of f prime of x. So I'm just going to say f prime of pi over 2 is equal to the sine 3 pi over 2. Okay, so again, we have that f prime of pi over 2 is equal to the sine of 3 pi over 2 times e raised to the cosine of pi over 2 times negative sine of pi over 2 plus cosine of 3 pi over 2 times 3 times e raised to the cosine of pi over 2. Well, the sine of 3 pi over 2 is 1, 2, 3 movements of pi over 2, so we're looking at negative 1. We have cosine of pi over 2 is equal to 0, and e to the 0 power is 1. And then we have the sine of pi over 2, which is equal to 1, but then it's negative. And then we have a plus. Well, the cosine of 3 pi over 2 is equal to 0. So that's equal to 1. F prime of pi over 2 is equal to 1. Did I make a mistake? Nope, I'm good. Let's get on to part B coming up right now. Okay, so they're going to define a new function for us and say that k of x is equal to h times f of x. So we're going to find k prime of pi over 2. This is just saying, okay, we're going to change this up a little bit. We're going to give you this function h, which is in the form of a graph. And I don't know what function h is, but inside of h you have another function of f of x. So to analyze k prime, you just have to recognize that it is a function inside of a function and that you have to use the chain rule. So we have k prime, and let me just keep this the proper casing because, you know, You do wrap it. You can't, lowercase is really technically different than uppercase, so keep those function names the same. Don't just arbitrarily introduce your own. K prime of x is equal to, well, with the chain rule, you do the derivative of the outside function first. Something you may have done correctly with part A, but just because this question has function names as opposed to actually having the function, it can throw students off. H prime of f of x times f prime of x, and now we're going to analyze that at pi over 2. Okay, so as we look at this, we already know that f prime of pi over 2 is equal to 1. That was the first part of the question, but we need to analyze what f of pi over 2 is. So a little bit of scratch work here, which I'm going to erase so I have some room, but f prime of pi over 2 is equal to the sine of 3 pi over 2 times e to the cosine of pi over 2. So again, we have the cosine of pi over 2 is equal to 0, so we have this function e floating around in here, but the way I've set this up, and it was similar to the actual question itself, it doesn't play as major a role in the problem as you would think. We have e to the 0 power is 1, and the sine of 3 pi over 2 is equal to negative 1. So now we're looking at h prime of negative 1 times what f prime of pi over 2 was equal to. Already we figured that in part A, which is 1. Now if you incorrectly found f prime of pi over 2 in part A, but then used whatever that incorrect answer was correctly in this part of the question, you're still going to get the full credit for part B, at least as far as I understand from the trainings I've gone to. So now we have h prime of negative 1. So we have here h, and at negative 1, it looks like that h is like 1.5, but we don't want h of negative 1, we want h prime of negative 1. We just simply want the slope. Well, these are all line segments here. So from negative 2 to 0, the slope of h, or the value of h prime, is equal to negative 3 over 2. So therefore, k prime of pi over 2 is negative 3 over 2 times 1, which is negative 3 over, all right. And this doesn't have a word problem scenario, so there's really no reason to write a sentence in terms of, putting it in context. You could say, and we are identifying here that the slope of k, or that k prime, is not equal to negative 3 halves everywhere. It's specifically at the value of pi over 2. So part C coming up right now. So in part C, we have a new function being defined. Let m of x is equal to be equal to g of negative 2x times h of x. Find m prime of 2. Really not much of a different question than part A, where we have a function which is the product of two functions. It's just, again, in part A we could see that function. That's what we're comfortable with, and hopefully your teacher's been doing enough problems with tables and graphs that you're comfortable with this as well. It's just, again, the way the information is given and the functions are given to you, it can throw students off a little bit. So, hopefully, it won't throw us off. M prime of x is equal to the first times the derivative of the second, plus the second times the derivative of the first, and this needs the chain rule. Derivative of the outside function is g prime. Now finish that chain rule. You take the derivative of the outside function, now multiply by the derivative of the inside function. And there we have our product rule that also includes our chain rule. Now, m prime of 2 is equal to g of negative 4, because negative 2 times 2 is negative 4, times h prime of 2 plus g prime of negative 4. Again, your negative 2 times 2 times negative 2 times h of 2. And here's where our graph again comes into play. G of negative 4, and our table. G of negative 4 is equal to 4. H prime of 2. We'll come in over here at 2. This is a graph of h, but we want the slope, and for this segment, the slope is negative 2 over 3, plus g prime of negative 4. Well, at negative 4, g prime is equal to negative 2 times negative 2 times h of 2. Now, h of 2, not the derivative. So at 2, okay, let's see here. From 0 to 3, we have a slope of negative 2/3. So we have 0 plus a slope of negative 2/3. Slope is a change in y per 1 unit of change in x, and we're moving 2 units. So it's going to be that slope of negative 2/3 off of the initial amount of 0. It's going to be 0 plus negative 2/3 times 2, which is going to give us negative 4/3. So we're looking at negative 8 over 3. Negative times negative is positive, times negative is negative. We have 2 times 2 is 4. 4 times 4 is 16 over 3. And we are looking at negative 24 over 3. Which, of course, we know is negative 8. So therefore, m prime of 2 is equal to negative 8. Part D coming up, which is involving, well, we'll figure that out when we get there right now. And for our last part, is there a number c on the closed interval from negative 5 to negative 1 such that g prime of c is equal to negative 1? And justify your answer, of course, as always. How or what theorem guarantees that on some interval you're going to have some specific slope or derivative? What says that you are going to have a c such that the instantaneous rate of change, the slope of the tangent line, the value of the derivative at a point, is equal to an average rate of change? Now, in the past, and actually like the question that this is inspired by, often when we do questions involving the mean value theorem, which, by the way, there is one for integrals and one for derivatives, they often just use the endpoints of the closed interval. And I noticed on some of the more recent AP questions, they give you a closed interval, but they don't necessarily use those end values for that mean value theorem. So on this table of values, is there a set of values of x somewhere between and maybe including negative 1 to 5 or negative 5 to 1 where the average rate of change is equal to the requested instantaneous rate of change of negative 1? Well, we have 6 minus 0 over negative 5 minus negative 1 does not come out to be negative 1. But if we play around with these, and I'm going to kind of glance at my notes just to kind of make sure this goes as quickly as possible. When we look from negative 4 to negative 2, but you would be playing around with that for a minute, we've got 4 minus 2, which is equal to 2, and we have negative 4 minus negative 2, which is negative 2, and that average rate of change comes out to be, well, negative 1. So we're going to start this by showing that we calculated somewhere within this closed interval an average rate of change that is equal to negative 1. Awesome. Okay, so we have an average rate of change of negative 1. Now, that means we're going to be justifying that there is a c such that the slope of the tangent line, or the instantaneous rate of change, is equal to negative 1, the same as this average rate of change. That means you're going to be using the mean value theorem to justify that, and the mean value theorem that says that a function must be continuous on a closed interval, well, that's where the differentiability comes in that I erased. G is differentiable, and it made a statement of basically everywhere, so it just said it was a differentiable function. Therefore, G is continuous on the closed interval. Now I'm pointing to this, but actually I'm going to be using the closed interval from negative 4 to negative 2. And differentiable, and just for good measure, I'm going to include on that open interval, G is differentiable. G is continuous in the closed interval and differentiable in the open interval, and therefore, by the mean value theorem, there is at least, there can be more than one, at least one C such that G prime of C, and make sure you use a different letter, use that C, don't put in an X, is equal to negative 1 on negative 4 to negative 2, and therefore on negative 5 to negative 1, because, well, negative 4 to negative 2 is inside negative 5 to negative 1. I missed a true. Bam! Go do your homework.